This episode of the Global Jigsaw is dedicated to the small Caribbean nation of Haiti. It's the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, still terribly scarred by a powerful earthquake that struck more than a decade ago. But the road to recovery has led to a dead end, with Haiti now dealing with a man-made menace that has made it one of the most dangerous places on Earth. Here is a snapshot of media reports on gang brutality, put together by my colleague Luis Fajardo, and the warning: this program contains graphic descriptions of violence.
A gang opens fire at a local neighborhood in a town just outside Port-au-Prince. A charcoal vendor from the Cité Soleil slum says gang violence is claiming innocent lives in her neighborhood. An emerging vigilante movement starts to show its face in the capital. Several suspected gang members are lynched in a central street. Men in Port-au-Prince shout their allegiance to Boakale, one of the emerging vigilante groups. A prominent journalist posts a video clip showing men as they sharpen knives and machetes, preparing for another weekend of violence.
Killings, kidnappings, and rapes are the daily lot in Haiti. It's come to this despite huge support from the international community, in aid worth an estimated $13 billion following the earthquake. Plans for a new international deployment led by Kenya have stalled amid the debate about how much of a help or hindrance foreign assistance is. In this episode, we take stock of the arguments and ask what hope is there for Haiti. I'm Crassie Twig, and this is The Global Jigsaw, an original podcast from BBC Monitoring, zooming in on political, security, and social shifts around the world through the lens of its media. Our team listens to, watches, and analyzes media narratives in 100 languages.
Radio Tehran.
Western countries are not the international community. That era has finished.
Hell on Earth. That's an expression that was used about Gaza recently. And it's language that residents of Haiti's capital, Port-au-Prince, or Port-au-Prince, as they would pronounce it, would be familiar with.
The UN Secretary General has been talking most recently about the sort of Gaza situation. But even before that, he was using terms relating to Haiti that we've heard since about Gaza, like a living nightmare, humanitarian crisis, obviously talking about the complete sort of disintegration of the state.
Pascal Fletcher from our Miami team has observed the conditions that justify the use of such hyperbole: gangs multiplying, taking over territory, and brutalizing its people.
Criminal gangs, believed to number more than 200, have basically sort of taken over large swathes of the capital, Port-au-Prince, and large areas of the interior of the country as well. We're talking about gangs who kill, rob, kidnap, hijack buses, rape. And this is the sort of daily life that we're seeing. I mean, this is the situation that exists now and has existed at least in a pretty intense rate for about 2 years. Some people would even call it a situation of anarchy and a complete lack of control of the state and the government.
And you said that this kind of violence happens mostly in the capital and around the capital. So it's not really affected the whole country, has it? So paint me a little bit of the picture of what you actually see there, you know, the beautiful turquoise seas and the amazing nature and this hellscape really in the middle of it.
Well, if you imagine a Caribbean island, you see crumpled hills. Haiti being part of Hispaniola is quite a hilly geography. You know, as you say, the turquoise sea, the sweep of the bay in Port-au-Prince. Port-au-Prince itself is beautifully set in a kind of mountainous cradle. And as you get closer, obviously, you see that a lot of the housing looks like sort of higgledy-piggledy houses built on the ravines and the mountainsides. Quite a sort of messy, sprawling urban area.
Haiti could be a Caribbean paradise, attracting tourists seeking sun and sea, much like the Dominican Republic next door, with which it shares the island. But its political instability goes back a long way. Let's have a quick tour of Haiti's history with a fact file from another BBC monitoring colleague watching Latin America, Rachel Krieger.
Haiti became the first nation to successfully gain independence through a slave revolt when it threw off French colonial rule and abolished slavery in the early 19th century. But independence came at a crippling cost. The country had to pay reparations to France, which demanded compensation for former slave owners. The 19th century quote-unquote independence debt was not paid off until 1947. There have been recent calls for France to repay that money, but it has so far resisted the idea. Chronic instability, dictatorships, and natural disasters in recent decades have left Haiti as the poorest nation in the Americas. An earthquake in 2010 killed an estimated 300,000 people and caused extensive damage to infrastructure and the economy, still visible today. A UN peacekeeping force was invited in to help stabilize the country in 2004, which withdrew in 2017. In 2021, President Jovenel Moïse was assassinated in the capital, Port-au-Prince. Amid political stalemate, gang violence took off on an unprecedented scale. Around 200 gangs now control 80% of the capital. More than half of the population live below the poverty line, and 5 out of 11 million depend on humanitarian aid for their survival.
In short, Haiti's turbulent history is marked by political instability, authoritarian rule, and social injustice. And as if this wasn't bad enough, it was hit by a natural disaster of mega proportions. The number of people killed in the 2010 earthquake is still disputed.
We'll never really know because they were buried in mass grave in the dusty plains north of the capital using bulldozers. We'll never really know how many people died.
More than a decade on, the damage is still visible in the capital. The elegant National Palace, which had stood as a symbol of Haiti's independence and sovereignty for over a century, is now a visual metaphor with its viciously broken lines of a country in dire need of repair.
And then when you saw the extent of international help, I think the estimate is that something like $13 billion was pumped in after the earthquake by, you know, the international relief effort in international charities. And of course, as we know, there was a huge military operation to assist in the reconstruction. Yes, elections were held. Yes, if you like, the political life continued, but there's a sense that perhaps it never really got back to a functioning capacity. And that, you know, who would have thought that just more than a decade later we'll be perhaps in an even worse situation with the country on its knees with these rampaging gangs paralyzing the country?
Gangs are not new to Haiti. Politicians have long been accused of using gang power to eliminate opponents and sway elections. There was always a high rate of criminality, feeding off periods of political upheaval and social unrest. But it was the assassination of President Moïse that triggered the current vortex of violence.
Dans la nuit hier pour l'ouvrir matin, un commando débarqué dans résidence.
The 2021 assassination of President Jovenel Moïse accentuated a power vacuum. There was no head of state. And since then, these gangs have just proliferated, not just sort of large, well-known gangs, but smaller gangs, all of whom occupy their own little fiefdoms around the capital. Maps have been drawn with colored points showing, you know, just how these gangs occupy different parts, their own little neighborhood, their own little corner. There are sort of fiefdoms within fiefdoms. Some of the major gangs control the major exits to the south. Others control the area to the north of the capital and the main highway to the east of the Dominican Republic. Others control and prey on the highways leading north along the coast and into the interior. Something like 9, maybe 10,000, maybe 15,000 involved directly in this kind of gang activity. And of course, it's just the way it works now.
Gangs profit from their territory as they prey on any commercial activity passing through. So they fight to expand their turf, creating more misery.
There's a gang called G9 Famille, which has always traditionally controlled the Cité Soleil slum and some parts, the Varro oil terminal area. And they often fight with each other. G9 and Famille fights with another gang called G-Pep. Even individual neighborhoods of central Port-au-Prince, there's one called Bel Air, there's another called Solino. The respective gangs there fight each other regularly and obviously displacing people. If you can imagine, you know, market women who really drive the sort of micro economy here, who are the mainstay of the main markets. Often they come in or they go to the countryside to seek produce. All that's now been disrupted. Often they're kidnapped on buses, the rapes take place, they can no longer carry out that kind of ground-level transactions.
Gangs armed mostly with weapons trafficked from the US killed nearly 5,000 people in 2023 alone, according to the UN. The devastation they are causing to Haitians cannot be overstated. They've torn into the fabric of Haitian life, disrupting education, healthcare, food and energy supplies.
500,000 children no longer with access to school. We're talking about poverty levels, which were already bad, now affecting nearly half of the population and believed to be living in sort of acute poverty and with severe hunger problems, you know, food problems, problems in finding food on a daily basis. We're constantly hearing of hospitals having to either stop operating or even evacuate in this extremely sort of violent atmosphere. The port terminal that supplies the country with fuel is called Varro. That's also in the hands of a gang, G9, who basically also extort the drivers who have to go in there and take the fuel out and distribute it. So once you get gang war flares on a particular day in the Cité Soleil slum, that can often cut off the whole country for fuel for days and create a kind of chokehold.
In the absence of law and order, locals have been taking matters into their own hands. But the result is more violence. And the warning, some of the details are disturbing.
Local inhabitants have often tried to sort of block these routes to stop the gangs coming in. So you've got all kinds of blockades going on, often in a spontaneous response to the gangs. Suddenly, some people started sort of pushing back. There's also been a quite aggressive vigilante movement called Bois Calais, which has also carried out blockings of route and pursued gang members and perhaps even non-gang members, you know, just not knowing who people are, making mistakes, you know, even perhaps killing innocent people. You know, lynching people or after the police captured them when certain gang suspects were seized by police. Suddenly you had a crowd of people gathering and they would take them from the police, you know, by force and then basically lynch them, throw tires on them and then burn them.
What you can hear is the sound of a chilling video posted on social media showing knives and machetes being sharpened.
You know, this whole atmosphere of fear and suspicion leads to people identifying possible suspects without any proof or official confirmation. And the next thing you know, somebody's being cornered and killed.
And how do foreign aid agencies manage to get aid to the millions of people in Haiti who still need it? Because in a normal situation, the aid agencies would talk to the government, right? So who are they talking now? Are they talking to all these different gangs because they have to pass through their territory?
The whole aid structure has been severely disrupted. One of the ways I think they were trying to get around was shipping in aid to the coastline and then using smaller boats to distribute it around the country. The gang activity is actually extended to the water. And we've seen over the last months quite frequent reports of piracy. The gang's basically taking to the sea, attacking boats. So food distribution possibility is being stymied.
You are listening to the Global Jigsaw from BBC Monitoring. Let's check in with the media. How do they operate in this dangerous environment?
Quite an active and heavily populated media scene, as I say, between journalists still there. It's still quite vibrant and healthy. Having said that, it's perhaps not so healthy to be a journalist there. We constantly hear reports of journalists being, you know, threatened, shot, kidnapped. These are the journalists who are actually there on the ground. Many have chosen to leave or to go into hiding or have to be very careful how they operate. But having said that, it is still a remarkably kind of vibrant news filters through in all the sort of various forms, as I say, from the, you know, the page one Le Nouveliste with its, even continues with its cartoons and its front page headlines, to these quite active websites.
And it seems the media does play an important role in this chaotic landscape. Are they relied on to provide vital information for survival, for people to navigate this labyrinth of dangers?
Certainly, I think where you tend to see the tip-offs that something's going on is on social media, where suddenly tipping off that there's shooting and there is a flood of people running in this particular neighborhood in the south. So often the tip-offs, you know, including pictures or perhaps a bit of audio, comes from the social media, and then it filters through the ecosystem, and then you tend to see more developed reports on the websites, on the news websites, maybe even a day later in Le Nouveliste with a more kind of rounded story.
What can be gleaned from opinion pages? How do Haitians see their own country and its place in the world?
The Le Nouveliste publishes almost daily editorials, and it's really quite active editor-in-chief, France Duval. And he often asks, how long is this going to go on? How bad does it have to get before the international community reacts? How long do people have to suffer? Is the world really watching? Why isn't the world watching? Why can't they see the suffering? You know, that tone has been going on. Is anybody listening? Is anybody watching?
There's been talk of a new international initiative. The idea was that Kenya would lead another UN-approved mission to Haiti to fight the gangs. Here's President William Ruto talking about it.
In another part of the world, the situation in Haiti highlights the global nature of security challenges.
He got a standing ovation in the European Parliament. But this initiative has had plenty of critics and stumbling blocks in its way. To give us the Kenya perspective, here is Beverly Ochieng from our Nairobi team.
So Kenya had been a member or a non-permanent member of the Security Council in the year that Haiti had put in an appeal to get support for the gang violence that proliferated after the president was assassinated. And Kenya saw it as a Pan-Africanist cause. And they've been trying to build their diplomatic standing, especially under President William Ruto currently. So they took up this mandate and they got quite a bit of support from Western governments. They talked about how much the crisis in Haiti resonated with them because they thought they wanted to support fellow Africans dealing with violence. So for them, it was about building that diplomatic standing. It was about them seeing it as a godsend, which is how the then foreign minister had framed it. And it was also about building their international support and international reputation as peacemakers, not just within the region in Africa, but in other parts of the world.
What experience will this police force have that would enable it to deal with a crisis far away that is so different from anything it has dealt with before?
So just after the government felt quite confident that they would be going to Haiti, there was training that was ongoing. So they were going to get paramilitary support. They were going to get weapons and facilitation from the money that was being given, especially by the US. They pledged nearly $2 billion for the initiative. And then they were also getting language training, because one of the biggest concerns that arose was that Haiti is Creole and French speaking, not necessarily like the French that would be taught in Kenya or in Nairobi. So that's part of the training that the forces were getting. And this was a police contingent, not the army, not any sort of, you know, paramilitary battalion. So they did need that level of reinforcement, because the level of violence they were going to be dealing with in Haiti is quite different from criminality in Kenya or even some of the previous peacekeeping missions.
And how did this idea go down in Kenya? Was everybody pleased? Was anybody against it?
For the most part, people were against it, which is what led to the court case, which was filed by a prominent lawyer. One of the arguments that they put forward was that it was not constitutional to send out a police force to another country. And then there were other arguments that surfaced because it was largely being backed by the US, by Canada, and people felt that Kenya was now a Western conduit, and also that Kenyan police were being given as cannon fodder for a region where other Western forces have failed to contain the violence. And then the other issue that also arose was Kenya's own human rights record. The police have never had a good reputation. This was coming in a year where we'd already had anti-government protests. There were allegations of police brutality. It's something that has constantly come up with the Kenyan police force. So the concern was that they would be going to a place where they'd be facing brutal violence, but that that cycle of violence would only repeat itself because of the allegations that Kenyan police have often been behind instances of brutality.
There have been legal obstacles, as you mentioned, in the way of this plan. So where are things now?
So the High Court has halted any deployment. They did agree with the lawyer's argument, the activist who filed the petition, that it is unconstitutional for Kenya to send a force to another country because it doesn't quite work like a UN peacekeeping mandate. And President William Ruto himself did say that he will instead not go through the route by the UN. They will treat it as a bilateral agreement. So he is keen to push forward with this, but it's not quite clear if he will actually flout the court order and indeed send forces to Haiti. So there's been some reactions, which we've picked up on, you know, both in Kenyan media as well as in our own monitoring, of how people in Haiti feel that the court is blocking something that would have possibly given them some hope.
What Bev was describing there, this idea that an African nation is being used by the West to do its work while giving it a pan-Africanist facade, has been bluntly called by some blackface imperialism. Opponents of the idea even call these missions in Haiti invasions. They point out that Haiti has experienced numerous interventions by foreign forces. The French in colonial times, Americans on several occasions in the last century, Brazilian and Nepalese troops more recently as UN peacekeepers. And now they say the Kenyans are sent to clean up their mess. And Haitians don't seem entirely sold on the idea either.
The imperialism wants to use Kenya to invade Haiti with over 1,000 or 2,000 soldiers.
Many Haitians have second thoughts and fear another foreign, as they call it, intervention, even if it comes from a, if you like, as what's, you know, a brother African country, because as we know, the Haitian culture is so closely linked to Africa. What will this intervention lead to? Will it help? Will it not? Will it bring more violence? There's a lot of questions and fear about that. It must be remembered that UN peacekeeping force, the Brazilians, they were to a large extent, I think, quite well known in the city, and they did restore order in parts of the capital. But having said that, the UN mission was the subject of a lot of criticism. Nepalese troops were accused of bringing cholera in the wake of the earthquake. That damaged the image of the UN peacekeeping force.
The UN peacekeeping mission has been a mixed bag. Its limited success often undermined by crises like the cholera epidemic and accusations of sexual abuse of minors by UN peacekeepers. So that's stuck in the minds of Haitians.
Si c'est ça yo konnen, yo vin pote et yo vin nan quartier populaire, yo vin louvri coup de balle.
One warning came from Jimmy Cherizier, known as Barbecue, who is the chief of the feared G9 and Famille gang. He warned international forces who might come to Haiti that if they commit abuses, his gang will fight them.
Let's not forget a slave revolt that created the first black republic in the world, a history of sort of throwing off foreign interference and occupation and French colonialism in those early days that also persisted through the U.S. occupation, which the military occupation that took place between 1915 and 1934. So there's a sort of spirit of this of resistance against foreign interference, and that still persists in the psyche, if you like, of Haitians.
Desperation in Haiti has reached such levels, and not for the lack of help from the international community. Billions of dollars have been pumped into the country in aid relief and reconstruction funds. But what has it done for Haiti? This is a question that's been asked again and again.
Just about every international organization and charity under the sun, from the American Red Cross to the Cuban doctors, basically helping out, huge outpouring and sort of considerable sympathy for the plight of Haitians after that earthquake. it then became part of this continuing debate in the world about the extent of just how useful international aid can be and up to what point, you know, when the rescue and the recovery operation stops and then the sort of the relief part begins again, the reconstruction, how much is useful, how much isn't, how much maybe too much, because it creates a situation of dependency, perhaps doesn't allow local institutions to thrive and grow and recover, or even the local economy. If you flood a country with donated and cheap rice, what happens to the local rice farmers? Does it kill their market?
Market distortion is just one argument against what some are calling the aid state, arguing that the substantial and continuing international aid may have helped to exacerbate Haiti's biggest troubles.
Haiti became a bit of a test case even, or certainly a cause for debate about how international aid can really work effectively to bring a country back up again, and to what extent it then it might hinder that. You know, people wonder, well, it wasn't so long ago where there was this massive, massive aid effort that included UN peacekeeping. UN peacekeepers were already there, big Brazilian contingent, and they were visible. But they left, and the whole gang situation got worse again. So was there really an effort to create and maintain a local police? The Haitian army was abolished. Even today, the Haitian armed forces is tiny, is not really back on its feet. Maybe if it existed, it could be useful in fighting the gangs, but there's always a fear that perhaps it would be used again for political or criminal purposes. And even now, it's known that many of the gang members are former members of the police.
It's perhaps safe to say that after all Haitians have been through, they find it hard to pin high hopes on this latest foreign mission.
Nobody doubts the good intentions of a lot of the efforts to help, but I guess the question has to be asked, is the world going about it the right way? This operation, perhaps it's too paternalistic. Perhaps what's needed is a bit of tough love. Maybe there's comes a point where the country really needs to sort of stand on its own feet through its own institutions. I mean, it's not easy to draw a conclusion.
Thank you to Pascal Fletcher, Beverly Ochieng, Luis Fajardo, and Rachel Krigia. That's all from the Global Jigsaw team, Krista Shaturi, Elchin Suleimanov, and me, Krassi Twig. The man on the mixing desk is John Boland, and our editor is Judy King. We hope you will enjoy season two. Do spread the word and tell your friends about it. And if you would like to suggest a story or share your feedback, write to us at the Global Jigsaw, all one word, at bbc.co.uk. And thanks for listening.